Friends, why are we now bothering about what we eat, what we do, what is the kind of food we should have? This is called reductionism. You know, man looks at things in bits and pieces each time. Let us for a change look at the whole. Why are we here? Where did we come from? What is our motto? And where are we going? If you look at all these things and think about it, you will come to one conclusion, which I want you to take home. It is not what you eat that keeps you going. It is what eats you that keeps you going. It is not what you eat that kills you. It is what eats you that kills you. You know what that means? Your negative thoughts. So the boss in the whole game of life is the human mind. Where is the mind? Never mind. But the mind is in, whole body is mind. In quantum physics, there is no matter, there is only energy. So you are a part of this universal energy, otherwise called universal consciousness. And you and I are so closely related, not by blood, not in family, not in race or language, but the energy that flows in you and the energy that flows in me is identical. So the first principle that we should know is this world is interconnected. Whether it is philosophy or science, it means the same thing. The world is interconnected is the philosophy of the philosophers of yore. But right from Newton's gravitational theory down to the quantum physics, the interconnectedness of this world is shown. So one doesn't have to, as a matter of fact, one of the speakers earlier said, one doesn't have to eat food to survive. Our energy mainly for survival comes from the ultraviolet rays of the sun. The sun shines on this planet and the energy is in a Schumann ring. And from the Schumann ring, each one of us gets his or her energy. As a matter of fact, there are, you know, there was a Swami I saw in Karthikeyan's house who wouldn't eat anything. He will look at the sun for about 4 hours in the morning and then he survives. He can go, he went to Manasarovar with Karthikeyan. He has got the video. And when all these people had about 10 covers of clothing, that man had just a shawl and a kachcha and he was sleeping on the snow. No shoes. He was walking barefoot on the snow in Manasarovar. And he walked up the Himalayas barefoot. And I have seen some swamis in the Tibetan monasteries. They just lie down there. If you have a Turkish towel which is wet, you put it on his chest and say, dry this. In 10 minutes, the towel will be dry because he can increase the heat of this chest so much that the whole thing gets fried. All this is possible if you know how to control your mind and how to control your energy. I'll give you a small little bit of pranayama. When you take a deep breath in and chant Om, when you say Om, this is ordinary sound. But when it goes down through your vocal cord and vibrates the vocal cord, it becomes ultrasound. You know what ultrasound is? Ultrasound travels in straight lines and ultrasound has a lot of energy. When this ultrasound goes down to what is called the alveoli, the last bit of the balloon that exchanges gas between the blood and the air, it churns the water there and produces the bubbles, small bubbles, to coalesce with each other. This is called sonoluminescence. And it produces so much of energy that you can get energy by just doing proper pranayama. If you did pranayama for 5-6 hours to 10 hours a day, you probably don't have to eat any food. Now, coming back to the mundane life that you and I lead, we need some food. But we eat much more than what we need. I always tell, in the world there are two important diseases. India, we have the largest load of subnutrition and malnutrition. We have 47 million children who don't get even a single meal. And these children suffer from a disease called NIDS, not AIDS, Nutritional Immune Deficiency Syndrome. And they die like flies. As we are discussing here about vegetarianism, a few hundred children in India have died because of malnutrition. This is malnutrition. Then in today's Western world, there is what is called malnutrition, M-A-L-L, mal, where you get all this kind of junk food. You get hot dog, white dog, and all kinds of rubbish. And then you get some poisons in the tins and bottles, colored poisons. People who drink that and eat that kind of a stuff, the hot dog, they get mal, M-A-L-L, nutrition, which is called obesity in the West. So when the West has a big epidemic of obesity, India has a large epidemic of poverty and malnutrition. There again, there are two kinds of malnutrition. If you have seen children who are malnourished, some children are bloated up, they have edema all over the body, they have a lot of water collection. Some are very thin, drying up. The drying up one is called marasmus, and the thick ones are called kwashiorkor. The difference is, the child that is dried up has had some mother's milk, very little mother's milk. So it is called protein subnutrition. The child which is bloated up has had no mother's milk at all. The mother either died very soon or the mother left the child or what have you. And whatever food the child gets is not the good food, the good protein, so it damages the liver first and produces edema. Whereas the child which eats too much of the junk food becomes obese, becomes a diabetic very soon, gets heart disease and dies early. And the sad part of the whole thing is the Western epidemic of obesity is creeping into India because the West has come to India in a big way to do business here. So you can see even in a village, day before yesterday I was in a village where I saw Kentucky Fried Chicken, KFC. In a village, there's an arrow which says KFC. I really had tears in my eyes. If KFC could come to this village, in what way they have invaded? This is the biggest invasion. This is the cultural invasion. They invaded with the army in the olden days. Now they are invading with their culture. They want to sell and make money. As someone rightly said, today the world runs after money. So anything that you get from outside is not reliable because they just twist the facts to make money and sell their wares. Having said that, we can all sustain ourselves with the minimum food. That's what Ayurveda says, Hita Mita Ahara Sevi. Food what you like and food in small quantities, preferably many times in a day. Minimum 6 times a day you must feed yourself with small amounts of clean, good food. And there is no way any difference between vegetarianism and non-vegetarian as far as nutrition is concerned. If anyone of you here doubts that vegetarians do not get enough strength, because a lot of youngsters are told this by the Western media, that if you don't eat meat, you can't really grow up and you can't be strong. I tell them, please come and see our temple elephants, which are pure vegetarians. If any one of those people can fight with the elephant and then win the war, I think I will become a non-vegetarian myself. Please remember that even non-vegetarians, even people who eat meat, ultimately get their protein from vegetables only. And if you don't eat much food, you will be healthier. There was a professor of biochemistry in Yale University about 20 years ago. And one of the British prime ministers of yore, who was a champion in writing on anything, had written a book called, If You Chew Every Morsel of Your Food 20 Times, You'll Be Very Healthy. So there were a few group of fanatic students in the Yale University dormitory who were chewing their food 20 times, every morsel. If you chewed food every morsel 20 times, you hardly end up eating about 10 to 15 grams of protein a day, because it takes so much time. They couldn't go to class. They had to sit there and chew and chew and chew. And he kept a watch on their health as they went through the medical school for 4 years. And the conventional eating students, at the end of 4 years, he found that these chewing students who ate very little food were much healthier, happier, and tranquil compared to the students who ate the conventional food. So the inference is, we require very little food, and all the food that you need, you get from vegetables. There are more than about 4,000 scientific papers to say that cooked meat is one of the important causes of cancer. But would you believe all these 4,000 papers are hushed up by the industry? The meat industry is so powerful that the whole thing is hushed up. You can eat meat and survive, but that meat should not be cooked. We learn our science from nature, which is called biomimicry, a new science called biomimicry. Look at all the meat-eating animals. They eat raw meat. They don't eat cooked meat. There are two meat-eating animals which we have domesticated, cat and dog. Now, a dog or cat in the forest lives for 40 to 50 years. A cat or dog in your house, where you give it cooked meat and cooked milk, and that lives only for 15 years to 20 years. It has halved its lifespan. So if any one of you want to be a non-vegetarian, you must eat uncooked meat in its raw state. Now look at human physiology. We were arboreous, hunter-gatherers, sleeping on the forest and sleeping on the branches or trees when we were hunter-gatherers. And we could eat only what was available there, fruits and probably some vegetables. Now very interestingly, this was the era when we were very, very healthy. Some records show that we had no illness at all. The causes of death were two: A, old age; B, predation. No illness. All the illnesses started in the 10,000 years when we sort of started living in communities and trying to eat not just non-vegetarian stuff, trying to eat each other. That means hating one another. Today our biggest enemy is hatred. Recently, one of my articles was published in the British Medical Journal where I said the cause of killer diseases is your mind. The silent killer in your body is not hypertension or diabetes or cancer, but your own mind. And if this mind is poisoned and it hates someone, your own body gets the damage and not the one who you hate. Let me tell you how it happens. If I can take a photograph of yours with a biophoton camera, I can see every cell of your body, every atom of your body emitting a photon light. And when I look at that, they are so happy dancing. If all the cells, you have 120 trillion cells in your body, each one of these cells loves the other cell. That apart, it loves the cells of others. My cells love Karthikeyan cells as much they love my cells. Now imagine for a minute that I hate Karthikeyan. I want to damage Karthikeyan. I want to pull the carpet under his feet. And I want to get his chair and become the director of the CBI, Central Bureau of Investigation or whatever. Now what happens? My cells get so confused. My cells say, why is this fellow doing this? Karthikeyan is a part of me. Karthikeyan is like a hand or my head or my leg. So why am I harming him? So a time comes after some time, your own cells start hating your own cells. And that is what we doctors call as autoimmune disease. And you would be surprised. I just had this afternoon a SMS from a doctor in Calcutta. She is a very highly qualified doctor, Refa CP. She so beautifully wrote, Professor Hegde, thank you for your article on the mind in the Royal College Journal. And I have started using that on my patients with autoimmune disease, and my patients with cirrhosis liver are doing very well. Fascinating. This only goes to show that if we start loving one another, vegetarianism, non-vegetarianism and things like that pale into insignificance. Ultimately, what is needed is love, universal compassion. And that is what exactly is what is called good health. I'll give you the definition of good health. Good health is not absence of disease. Because the definition of disease, every one of us has a disease. Forget about it. But it doesn't kill you. We doctors connect disease with death so that they frighten you because we want more patients. I'll give you one example how we fool you. We tell you, if you're a diabetic, even if you're a South Indian eating rice, we tell you, you must start from tomorrow eating chapati. Now this creates a lot of problems in the house. The wife who doesn't know how to make chapati, she struggles to make chapati, she can't do it, and she does something which she doesn't like to do. This is very bad. Doing something which you hate kills you. Now the wife, she has to do it because she thinks the doctor said the husband will live longer if he eats wheat. Now I'll tell you the truth. Wheat contains wheat gluten. And wheat gluten is a direct damage to the pancreas. So wheat goes directly to your beta cells in the pancreas and keeps you a diabetic permanently. That is only disease mongering. I want my business. If every diabetic gets better and if there is no diabetes at all, what does the diabetic specialist do? Did you get the message? So friends, don't believe anybody, but believe yourself. This is the most important thing. So health is enthusiasm to work. Get up in the morning and ask yourself, do I have to go to work today? And if you're enthusiastic, you say, I am healthy. Two, enthusiasm to be compassionate. Ask yourself, do I want to help somebody today? Because what does the Sanatana Dharma say? Paropakarartham idam shariram. You are made for the benefit of others. Remember that? You are here for others' sake. And if you did that, you are absolutely healthy. That's what Ayurveda says. What does it say? Samadhatuhu samagnischa samadoshaha malakriyaha prasannatma indriyamana swastaitya vidyate. You get up in the morning, you sleep well, you eat well, you piss well, you shit well, you love well, and you don't hate nobody, you can't get any disease. How do you get disease? Krodha. You know what krodha is? Anger. Anger. Anger and danger are just one letter apart. D, you add D to anger, it becomes danger. And anger is an emotion which kills you. One of the very important causes of stroke is anger, sudden bout of anger. Krodha, shoka, depression, frustration. Bhaya, extreme fear. Ayasa, exhaustion. Viruddhanna bhojana, here comes the most important part. The wrong type of food at the wrong time. Viruddhanna bhojana. Taponalan. Taponalan is not doing anything. Sedentary life. You know, just lying down, doing nothing, lazying around. Sitting in the chair for hours together shortens your lifespan. Instead of sitting, you stand, you cut your lifespan. If you walk, you lengthen your lifespan. When you're talking, you know, I never rarely talk like this, sitting, standing in a place, because you know, this is only one mic. Supposing I have a collar mic, I keep walking. When I walk, I circulate my blood better. And I oxygenate my blood better in the lungs. So the better blood goes to my brain. I can think sharper and I can talk better. So it is very important that tapo nalan. Then what does it say? Katva amla kshara lavana tikshnoshnati rakta pratopayat. All kinds of unnecessary things we eat. And that's what produces every disease. What's the treatment? Hita mita ahara sevi. What you like. Now when you sit for eating, love your food. And think of the person who has cooked the food. And imagine the food will be very happy for you. And you start watering in the mouth before you see the food. And when you start seeing the food, the watering, the enzymes in all over the gut start secreting. So you get better digestion, better absorption, and you're more tranquil when you eat. Think of the wife or the husband or whoever has cooked it for you, and the effort that has gone into it. And eating with the hand, you're giving your bioenergy. I still remember, there was one very famous justice called Justice ASPIN. Is that right? He was an ICS man. And from the ICS, he became a judge and became a Supreme Court judge. After passing the ICS in those days, these Indians had to go to England to study ethics and manners and how to eat and all. So he was living in a house where the house lady said, "Mr. Iyer, you must eat with the fork and the spoon." Mr. Iyer said, "No, I have my hands. I'll eat with my hands." She said, "Dirty hands? You know, you're using that?" "No, madam, I'm washing my hands with soap and water." "No, no, here is a very nice spoke and spoon. Why don't you use it?" That fork and spoon has gone into so many mouths, but my hand has gone only into my mouth. And you're passing a lot of your bioenergy when you're eating with the food, and this energy makes it get digested easily. So, sita mita ahara sevi. Then, samikshakari, work very hard. Lot of us don't want to work. We want laze away, we want excuses, we want casual leave, we want sick leave, and all kinds of leaves. I had given an advice to the bankers some time ago. Every bank officer gets money if he goes and sees a doctor and gets a checkup. So I told the chairman's group, I said, "Look, from now on you make a new rule. One who doesn't go and see a doctor, one doesn't take anything, you give him a bonus of 5 or 6 lakhs every year." Because the minute he goes to see a doctor, he becomes a patient. Did you know that? An American professor of medicine, Leon Eisenberg, asked the brightest of the student in the class a question. Who is a patient? Do you know what the student answered? "A man or a woman who sees a doctor becomes a patient." Then she was shocked. "Is it what I have taught these students?" Then she asked, "When does he become a man or a woman again?" Do you know what the student said? "Rarely ever, comma, if ever, full stop." How does it happen? We say, this is your normal sugar. There is no definition of normal in our medicine. We're statistical. We have average. Like, for example, I'll give you, what is the normal height of Indian males? You did a study, 1,000 males and the Gaussian curve, plus mean plus 2 standard deviation. So 5.4 inches plus minus 2 inches is the normal for Indian males. Okay? We accept it as normal. So anybody outside that is abnormal and he requires treatment. Amitabh Bachchan comes for a checkup, 6.2. So what's the treatment we give? Cut his leg and make him 5.6. And then Jaya Bachchan comes for a checkup, 4.6. What's the treatment? Transplant a leg for her, make her also 5.2. This is exactly what we do. Mahatma Gandhi's blood pressure used to be 200 by 120. And who was not getting sleep? Sushila Nair, his doctor. But the old man never took any treatment. And he died of kidney disease, heart disease, blood disease, head disease, and all kinds of diseases. Did he? That would have spared, God save his life, if he had died of that. He didn't die. He lived to be killed. So this is what we do. That is what is called average becomes a normal. You get what is called false positive. Remember that? So if you know little statistics, for when you apply disease statistics to healthy people, you get on an average for every parameter checked by the doctor, 5 to 10% false positives. Now remember, now you go for a checkup in the hospital, TBS, your 500 parameters are checked at a given time. So for each parameter, 5% false positive. 500 parameters, 2,500 false positive. If 100 people go for a checkup, 2,500 patients come out. That is why they make you run on a heart day, they make you run on a healthy day, bupa walk, etc., etc. Because you make people who have not walked at all, make them walk 5 miles on the first day. Their knee joint is going to get damaged and they get pain and they come to the hospital. So one bakra has come. Now when they walk and somebody sees him walking with a little gasp, you better get a checkup. Your heart may not be very good. So he comes there, he gets a block and he becomes an angioplasty candidate. So you think they do this walking all for your good? No, for their good. This is called disease mongering. In the good old days when this first blood pressure first became a disease, do you know how? In Germany, some company made a chemical which lowered blood pressure. So how to sell it? So they had what's called a Wellman clinic, a beautiful ambulance, inside which a very beautiful sister sitting with a blood pressure apparatus. And this was parked outside the church on Sunday, outside the mall on weekdays, and outside the holiday season. And it says, come in and check up your blood pressure. So you go in and see this nurse, you get a little excited, so your blood pressure goes up. No, I'm not joking, I'm seriously telling you, I'm making it a little lighthearted, that's all. Because even if somebody touches you, it's called the alarm reaction, your blood pressure goes up. So when you look at this nurse, and then she ties that push thing on your hand, and then chuk, and she says, oh, your blood pressure, then finished. Then you're permanently blood pressure, because the doctor says, you start taking tablet today. And next day if you go and the blood pressure is normal, they say, that's because of the tablet. If you leave it, it'll again go up and hit the roof. Nothing of the sort happens. But once labeled, this is called labeling, you are permanently labeled. So don't you spoil your health. Ask yourself whether you're healthy and don't ask the doctor. If you can work hard, and if you can love others, compassionate, you're fine. Now why are we getting these diseases like blood pressure, cholesterol, so-called sugar and all? It is because when we were hunter-gatherers in the forest, predation was a cause of death. So God in his wisdom gave us a special system called the autonomic nervous system. So if you saw a tiger in the forest, you had to run away from the tiger. If you don't run away, the tiger will definitely kill you. If you run away, there is a chance that you may not be killed. So you run. For running, you require energy. Today, P.T. Usha can drink glucoside and run. In the forest, you don't get glucoside. So God said, okay, I will prepare good glucoside. God made the sympathetic system secrete a hormone called adrenaline. And this adrenaline goes to the liver. In the liver, God has kept a lot of gunny bags of sugar as glycogen. So it goes into the liver, releases the sugar from the liver, which is called neoglucogenesis. Actually, Aurobindo so beautifully said, Galen and Hippocrates gave us some hocus pocus in Latin and made us get frightened. So anyway, neoglucogenesis, you get sugar. So you start running, you get energy. Then to run, your blood pressure must go up, so your blood pressure goes up. To run, your heart rate must go up, it goes up, all because of adrenaline. Now when you run away from the tiger, all these things come down. Sugar comes down, blood pressure comes down, heart rate comes down. Today we have transplanted ourselves from that forest into the society, so-called society, civilized society. Civilized society in my concept is making man go more towards animal instincts. That's the part. Yes, it's over. Time over. Time over. Thank you very much. But if you want me to complete this whole story quickly, 2 minutes, 1 minute. Yes. Now what happens? Today everybody in society has become a tiger. Your boss is a tiger. Your assistant is a tiger. Your wife can be a tiger. Your husband can be a tiger. So you keep seeing these tigers every minute and every day, and your blood pressure goes up, your sugar goes up, your goes up. Now there is no time to run because you can't run away from these tigers. So you have to see, be there and suffer that. So this permanently remains high, and you die not because of any other cause. You die because of your mind. Your mind gets frightened. So friends, be tranquil. You will live as long as you live. I'll close it with an Irish couplet, which says, I eat whenever I'm hungry. This is what you should follow. Never eat when you're not hungry. I drink when I'm thirsty. If heavens don't fall down, I'll certainly live till I die. Thank you very much.